shine where you live. When we were school kids, hey, the rails are caught now, and I am falling down. Fools in a spiral round this town of steel.
Shaking, girl. I'm chilling the fever, so I've been on the sea. The wind shakes the leaves on a tree. And I'm a nervous wreck and I'm all shook up. And that's what you're doing to me right now. And I'm jumping. That's right, you got me shaking.
Everyone, can we just get a round of applause for our performer, Danny Savage? Make sure you follow them and support and amplify their work as you see them performing in the community. So, a couple of things, everyone. First of all, I have our first opportunities to award some of our door prizes. So thank you to CHS for our $200 gas gift cards. So we're going to start with the winner of our pre-summit social door prize, Michaela Schaaf. Michaela Schaaf. So if you are here, you can go out to the registration table and they'll be happy to give you your $200 gift card. Also, from our first timer breakfast, that winner is Amanda Jump from Columbus. So Amanda, if you want to stop by, you have a gift card as well. For any of you who have not won yet, there's a couple of ways for you to still get in the running. We are still going to have somebody win a door prize at the end of today's event. Also, you can see some QR codes that are out there in your programs, and you can find them on our website, because we would love to have you complete our feedback survey. You go ahead, use that QR code. It'll take you directly to the survey, and everyone who submits their response to our feedback survey, you are also entered in for one of the drawings of our $200 gas card. So I promised that we were going to talk about more food. And so are you guys ready for our next panel? Is that okay? So panels, if you want to go ahead and get comfy, because I made you stand over there for a while. So we'll let you get comfy. And then I'm going to let our moderator, Kate Herzog, she's going to introduce herself. And then we are now going to talk to our panelists regarding Hot Dish, Let's Talk About Food events. So everyone, please, a round of applause for our panelists.
How's everybody doing out there today? Looking good? Oban, looking good up there? Are you guys enjoying the summit or what? Yeah, yeah. If you guys see the MSI folks, give them, you know, a thanks, a appropriate hug or something like that. They have just put in so much work here, so really want to thank Maria, her team, Commerce team, for putting on a great summit. We're going to talk about food events. We've got a great panel here. Dawn Kopp, she is the CEO of the Downtowners Association in Bismarck. Dawn, pick your seat, whichever one you'd like. Blue Weber, Blue, you've got a crowd out there. Okay. Blue is with the Grand Forks Downtown Development Association. He's also mostly sane from doing events, but you'll see the cracks as we get going. Nancy is from Park River. Welcome, Nancy. We're really excited to have kind of a rural perspective in doing food events. And I was told that Keith from the Kilbourne Group oozes personality, and that's why we have put him up here on the stage. So Keith is going to talk a little bit about designing areas for food events. So you guys, grab some chair. I've got some questions to kick off. First of all, how many of you have organized a food event? A few of you. And you're still here to tell the tale. It does shorten your lifespan just a smidge. So we put on a street fair in Bismarck. Blue also, they do a street fair. Fargo's got a street fair. But Nancy, I kind of wanted to start with you. You guys have been doing some events in Park River. We talk a little bit about, and I think we've got some pictures that are going to roll behind you guys, and I took a few of yours, but talk about what you got going on in Park River. Right, here's a couple of pictures.
Am I on?
It's on. Yeah.
As you can see, we do a Tasty Tuesday. Every second Tuesday of the month, we try to bring in a food truck to our area. And this came about because we were lacking lunch options for tourists or residents in our community. We just didn't have enough lunch options. So we thought, well, what else could we do? So they thought, well, let's see if we can get food trucks to come to town. So that's how that started. It's sponsored through our community club in Park River. We don't necessarily have a chamber of commerce. We have our community club, and that's who started organizing it. So there was a small subcommittee that got together and met to start coming up with this idea and trying to contact the food vendors to see who would drive to Park River, North Dakota from 60, 70 miles away to come on an afternoon. That was a little challenging at times. So.
Nancy, what did you do? Did you have to bribe them, or how did you get them there? I know you said getting vendors has been difficult.
The food trucks, the first year we did it, was that, well, that won't be so hard. We thought with one truck. Then we got the one truck, and some of them didn't want to come because it's a part-time job. They do it on the weekends. They work during the day, or their husband parks their food truck for them, and then they go to it. Or they didn't want to drive 60, 70 miles and not make any money. This year's challenge, we thought, well, because the lines got very long and people got sick of waiting, so we're like, okay, let's take two trucks. We thought, you know, the first year with COVID kind of hit in and that kind of made it an issue. The next year it went a lot better. We found them, we called. I suppose we contacted 15 different trucks to see who would come. We found some that came and repeatedly came. But the lines were too long, so then the residents were like, how about two? So then we called for two. Some of them canceled, so we ended up with one. We were trying to eliminate the line so they could get through. Most people have, an hour to a half hour? So we were trying to feed them as best and fast as we could and given different options through our community. We really didn't have anywhere for them for lunch. We had a restaurant and the gas stations. Mm-hmm. So.
Although you can find a good gas station lunch in rural North Dakota.
You can.
Just FYI, Hot Stuff Pizza, putting a plug in for Hot Stuff.
And we only wanted to do it once a month because we did not want you cut into the business for our local business owners, but we wanted to give, like I said, a new option to the community, just something new, fresh, fun.
Awesome. And are you going to do it next year as well? Is this going to be an annual thing for you?
We haven't decided. There's some say yes, some say no. Some want to try and switch it to the evening since the daytime seemed to be a little harder. Maybe do it a Tuesday evening because as of right now, we really only have the gas stations in the evening and one restaurant that's open for supper. So. Gotcha. We have talked about doing it in the evening, like on a Tuesday, awesome. And keep the name, but.
And Blue, I know we've been talking about infrastructure for food events. If in the description, we talked a little bit about, there's basically three things you need to put on a good food event: water, toilets, and electricity. Blue, talk about your work with all three of those.
Yeah, I would say that this year has been our biggest challenge. Our street fair is on its seventh year, so it's slowly growing each and every year. This year we had 11 food trucks and I think 7 or 8 snack trucks. So we started to differentiate in having those. But one thing that we've realized with that is the city infrastructure. We are at max capacity. We have pulled all of our power from our town square, which I know there were some pictures on there. But we are at a point where we need more of that. And so we're not going to the city saying, hey, we want you guys to get us new food trucks. Just give us some of this infrastructure that can be used for this. We don't even want to be the gatekeepers of these power boxes. But if other people are wanting to show up and do these events too, here's the perfect platform for it. And so working both with our local energy provider and the city to kind of put in that infrastructure is looking very big for us for the next year.
Don, you've been doing, well, this was our 49th annual street fair, and you've been doing it for 86 years. What have you seen trend-wise from vendors? Like, Blue's talking about electricity. Even when I started, someone's got a crock pot and a little 110 household outlet, and now it's like, I'm running an air conditioner, and I need a 220 dryer plug, you know, to run my vendor setup. So what have you seen, you know, just trend-wise in the last 10 years to kind of accommodate vendors for food events?
Sure. So I think the biggest trend is that people are going more toward a food truck or a trailer instead of just a tent, where they bring all their wares and such and set up under a tent. So very good point. There's a lot more power needs that are necessary now to host an event, because most of those trucks and trailers just require more power. So luckily, we've been able to continually add in more power to our alleyways and accommodate a lot of the vendors that way.
And I think that's a really good idea. We've had power in our alleys in downtown Bismarck for 25 plus years to accommodate the street fair, essentially. And it takes more and more power to run these food events. But Keith, you guys, you know, recently designed and were a part of Broadway Square. How did you sort of take into account what the infrastructure needs were gonna be for these food events? Or, you know, I mean, that's the first thing I was always think about is water, power, toilets.
So it started from a place of collaboration with, you know, the users who are going to use the space and some of the people that were programming events within the space. So we tried to get a good understanding of, you know, the vendors that they are working with, the local people that were participating in this, what did they need? And that at least gave us a basis to start the design from. But then really trying to do a design that had as much flexibility in it as possible. So we talk about power a lot. Well, power is a really expensive infrastructure to put underground, and then to have the flexibility to have plugs all over the place. So, you know, a strategy oftentimes is let's put one central hub or a 200 amp area where we can hook into, and then we can distribute what we call like a spider situation or a spider tether or cord to that. So we can distribute kind of more localized power sources in different configurations around the space, depending on what the event is going to be.
So we're spider boxes is what we would call them in the food biz. It's basically a ginormous surge protector where you can plug like big 220 outlets or 120s in it. I knew nothing about electricity until I started dealing with like food carnies. And they're coming in and, you know, asking for huge amounts of electricity. So it's really something that you need to know about. Blue, I interrupted you on purpose. What did you want
to say? And it's just funny that you're talking about that. We're finishing up a lot of our new street construction downtown. And so what the city's been amazing as a partner on is because, like you said, infrastructure in that sense can be very expensive. So us, we really advocated for them putting in more pedestals around. So it's single power. It's able, we call them turtles, it's the same thing, but we're able to run these turtles everywhere and it's just single points. And so it's not having to redo an entire infrastructure. It's just giving us one little hotspot, basically.
Turtles, spiders, toilets, electricity, water. That's what you need for your event. Don, I just wanted to give one tip because this was a game changer for us about if anyone's done food events in the summer, there is one unwanted guest that you generally have. They're called wasps, hornets, whatever you want to call them. And there's one thing that Don found that has just been a game changer. Don, tell them about our garbage problem.
First, I want to say we are not sponsored by this product.
Yet.
But, and hornets and wasps are different.
Whatever.
Anyway, it's called Dumpstar. Not dumpster, but Dumpstar. And it's basically...
Write it down, Blue. Write it down.
Yes. Dump. Star. Because it's the star of the show. Anyhow, basically it's a citronella product in a granular form. And so you put these granules, you shake it from the little container into the bottom of your trash bins, and then you put your liners over the top, and it worked amazingly. I mean, it was a gigantic game changer. This year, our street fair was kind of cool, but last year we had a very warm, hot, typical September event. Anyhow, we were so skeptical because it sounds too good to be true. But then we actually tested it out, tried it out. We had a bake. We have a bakery downtown. They also used it in their trash bins that they were using because they set up right in front of their store. And the wasps and hornets totally stayed away. Very exciting.
I would totally be sponsored by Dumpstar as well. So if anyone is in the audience from Dumpstar, find me afterwards. Nancy, can you talk a little bit? You're working in a rural area. I know for us, we have a whole bunch of volunteers that are coming in to help us with the event. Who do you work with? What groups have you pulled in to maybe help you take the garbage or whatever, you know, electricity? Who's helping you? Or are you doing it yourself and then crying later in the evening?
There's a subcommittee of four of us that plan this event and try to organize it and market it and advertise and find the food vendors to show up. As far as the electrical, we ask them if they have a generator to please bring their generator. Otherwise, it falls on our public works director, Dennis, to say, Dennis, can you put the electrical board up today?
So. And is four people enough, or has it shaved some years off of your life?
It's a small community.
Everyone's got to pull their own weight.
It's rural. It's what you do. I mean, you sit on different events. I mean, if you're on the community club or your chamber, and that's your subcommittee, and that's how many. I mean, you know, our next big event will be our Super Santa Saturday, which is a committee of six.
Well, you're doing it, Nancy, and we're sending you all the love. And if you want to volunteer at the Park River food events, find Nancy. She needs some folks.
Throw some food trucks our way. Put a word out there. Say, we'd love to have you come to our town. Yeah.
Keith, you want to just talk a little bit more about kind of the food events that you have in Broadway Square, and did you learn any lessons afterwards, like, oh man, we should have put, you know, this piece of infrastructure in there, or what did you learn after it was all set up?
Yeah, so we started early in the design. There was a lot of discussion around where the food was going to be located within the space. So whether does the plaza itself hold the vendors, or is the plaza a supporting space of the vendors? So around electrical infrastructure, we sort of literally put one kind of right down the middle, and we said, well, let's put a space that's flexible enough that we can either go into the square space or we can go into the street space. And then as we started to kind of get the lineups of the planning and who is going to actually be here and who's going to be using the space more on a regular regular event schedule, working with the city, being able to shut down the street, that allowed us to realize that these crowds were going to be larger typically than what the space could hold, and then be able to position food to support it from the street side, and then let the pedestrian side live in the kind of more of the square space or the design space for that.
Sure. Blue and Don, we were talking a little bit about vendor duplication with street fairs. You know, we could have about 5,000 corn dog vendors, but we don't, because then they wouldn't make any money. So talk about how you kind of go through the vendors and, hey, this person looks great, this person seems insane, and what that process is like.
So for us, we really, since we are still so young as a street fair, we're still thirsty for anybody, but we did start capping it at one for each thing. And so we're trying to be very intentional, and it's difficult. There's not a ton of food trucks, but we're trying to be intentional with who we're looking for. So is it Somalian food? Is it street tacos? Is it corn dogs? And then we've started to dive into that realm of snacks too. It starts to take the burden off of the food trucks themselves and gives people an opportunity to have edible cookie dough or even, you know, a slushy, maybe a little wine slushy, things like that. So it really starts to pull away from that, but not just duplicating and creating more diversity as far as what you can eat.
Right. And Don, can you talk a little bit about our street fair is a little different where we have these, service clubs and groups that do things as a fundraiser.
Right. So our street fair is also very food heavy. So we have about 45 food vendors that attend street fair every year. So ours is a little bit different. We cap usually really specialty items at two. So we never go beyond two for something like turkey legs or lefse or something on that line. We do have quite a few corn dog vendors. But again, it's just because the sheer amount of food vendors that we have. As far as street fair for our organization is one of our largest fundraising events for the year. and that's very typical in every community that holds these events. But we also invite other service organizations and churches and that type of thing or body or organization to participate and use Street Fair as a fundraiser as well. So we have a lot of churches, we have Boy Scout troops, we have
Booster clubs.
Pardon? Lions clubs.
Yeah,
booster clubs, fraternal orders, that type of thing that utilize Street Fair as their own fundraisers. So it's a really exciting thing to have a fundraiser within a fundraiser within a fundraiser.
There was practically a mutiny when Faith Lutheran did not bring rice pudding one year to the event. That's all we heard. Where's the rice pudding? Yeah. Where's the rice pudding? So if your churches and groups, they were expected to be there. The Lions Club expected to be there with their turkey legs, or else there would have been some harm that would have happened. So it's been really come synonymous with the Street Fair in Bismarck, and people really look forward to it, which is great. We've got maybe like 4 minutes left, so I wanted to do maybe just a lightning round, and maybe some advice that you'd give these folks out here who are thinking about, let's just say they come up to you afterwards like, oh, a food event, that sounds fun. I want to do that.
I have something so quick, like that's just okay. Important is if you ask people to be there for free, they almost always won't show up. And so we learned that we were doing Mondays, which is very cheesy and tacky of a name, but the idea was similar to the Tasty Tuesdays, where across the street from our city hall, we would just have about 2 to 3 food trucks show up every Monday. And the first month we said, you know, it's free. We just want food trucks there. And we would get confirmation people saying, yeah, we'll be there. And they would never show up. And so we realized that charging $50 doesn't mean anything for us, but it gives them this reason to be like, okay, now I have a reason to be there. And it kind of just forced their hand on it. And we did 2 of them. And it just started really small. And it was 2 years that we did it just to kind of try it out. But that was one of our biggest findings.
Yeah, got skin in the game. You're going to show up.
Again, I think it's really important just to realize that you want your vendors to be successful. Because if they're successful, your event will be successful. Try to introduce yourself and get to know the vendors a little bit. It's probably impossible to get around to everybody during each event, or you can kind of activate some of your volunteers to make sure you can go out and say thank you for being here and that type of thing. And then the last thing that I'll say is double check everything, especially all of your major amenities that you are providing. So make sure you have someone on staff if something happens to power. Make sure you have somebody's cell phone number in your phone if your porta potties aren't.
Basically, Kate walks around with a fork to test every outlet, is what
yeah,
you're saying?
I
that's
do.
Her, like,
yes,
go-to.
That's, I have slept at an event we've done in my pajamas by a generator that was acting
but
up.
Hasn't?
So it's not a fun experience.
No.
Nancy, Keith, some advice that you'd give these people?
I would say you don't need to have a multi-million-dollar plaza to have a cool event. I mean, Fargo, we're blessed with that. Grand Forks is blessed with that, right? Dickinson's working on making one of these. The smaller communities, you know, some simple garden lights and $100 worth of extension cords, and have the business you're putting this up against or the vacant lot you're putting this up against donate a power plug for the day, right? Just to get some momentum started. And then you start to understand how do people react to this space and what additional stuff should we do better the next time? And you kind of have that incremental approach to how do we build infrastructure that ultimately supports what we want to do.
Yeah, a test event is great. Where are people coming from? Which direction are they walking? You know, I mean, that's some interesting ideas as well. Nancy, give us your best advice.
Should I go?
Before you retire from doing the food truck
they
thing.
They talk. Your food truck owners, they talk. Oh, they yes. talk about the community they were in. They talk about the crowd. They talk about how their customers were. I mean, so always remember that. They do talk. Mm-hmm. And we had ours in what we call our little park. It's got on the picnic table so that they could sit and eat lunch because if it's their lunch hour, they want to sit down and eat. So we always had to provide seating.
Yeah.
And I just want to say one more thing to organizers. There probably will be times during the event, especially during setup and maybe other times, when everything's going wrong at once. But if it takes another 5 minutes to get somewhere that's not literally on fire, everything's going to be okay, and you'll figure it out. So give yourself a little bit of wiggle room or a breath or some grace, because it's just not necessary to make yourself absolutely insane, because you'll feel insane anyhow.
Yeah. And I tease, they're great events for the community. I mean, we've got thousands of people that come for the street fair, and they're like, oh, this is great, it must be so much fun. You're eating cheese curds and you can eat all day long, and you're like, I'm so tired. Somebody let me take a nap. But it's so great for the community. We've been talking about, you know, building these amenities into the community. These events is what people look forward to. And they're really hard to put on, but it's totally worth it for your community, because I think that that's really what people are looking for. So we just wanted to give a little bit of advice for food events. If you have more questions, come find this crew. They'd be happy to you did start a fire. We're talking about things around fire. Fires happen.
We're not talking about that, but that's not food truck related. But yes, we start fires in our town square all the time, so we'll just leave that alone.
It happens. Okay. Well, give it up for our panel. Thank you guys so much. They did want me to mention there is a survey for the summit, so please take it. You'll see QR codes around the area here. And then I think, I don't know if, she is coming back. All right. I missed you. Come on up. Thank you guys so much, and we'll see you at your next sessions.
Get up and go.
All righty. Thank you very much for all of that amazing information. Now we are going to take a brief break as you start your afternoon concurrent session. So what you can do is you can start going to your concurrent sessions. You can also go to our website again or look in your forms. That'll tell you what our options are. We have one that's going to run from 1:30 to 2:15. You'll have a 30-minute break until our next session starts from 2:45 to 3:30. And then our final concurrent session for the day will be from 3:30 to 4:30. So feel free to enjoy that, and then we would love you all to come back for our closing remarks from our governor, and also so you can learn more about our EDA Public Space Initiative Placemaking Planning grantees and watch them win their award. So enjoy your concurrent sessions, and we'll see you back here at 4:30, everyone.
Turn for grace, it's a beautiful